Well, it's your girl Adeola. So this has been going on for God knows how long. I'm talking about corruption in the judicial system of Nigeria. The fact that regular people don't get justice. We need to talk about this, especially now that we have a new Chief Justice. In case you are watching me, my Oga, you not do well. The fact that this is still happening under this new administration. Oga Buari, Benebami, or Simbajo. We were all very hopeful that in your time, the rich and powerful people will no longer be oppressing the common people, forcefully taking other people's properties in Nigeria just because they can do it and get away with it, even though they can afford their own. As you guys know, so many Nigerians, after living abroad for years, sometimes for decades, they would want to go back and build a house in Nigeria so that they can retire in Nigeria. Well, in 2013, on this show, I talked about a Nigerian businessman here in the US, Ima Ohikwari, who, after working abroad for decades, saving money to retire in Nigeria, was finally able to buy a land in Asokoro and build a two-wing complex. The man worked in oil, gas, and telecommunication sectors here in the US as well as in the UK, and he spent 1 billion naira, money that he had been saving for decades that he's been working abroad. He spent that money to build a house in Nigeria where he can retire. But as soon as his family moved into the house, Alhaji Shehu Malami, that is the former Nigerian ambassador to South Africa, allegedly showed up and said that he owned the land on which the man built his house, and said he bought the land in 1984. And the man was like, he bought this land in 2006 from the former Minister of Transport, that is Alhaji Abibu Aliyu, and he produced all the necessary documents. Besides that, this man spent 3 years building his house in Asokoro. How come nobody showed up in the 3 years that he was constructing? Nobody showed up to claim the land, but they waited until he finished building his house, and then they came and they said, Malami owned the house. Anyway, they took it to court, but guess who showed up in court? That is a billionaire Emeka Ofor, a filthy rich Nigerian billionaire who made his money by taking huge contracts without delivering. During Abacha's time, Emeka Ofor was allegedly paid $100 million, $100 million, to maintain the Port Harcourt refinery. Of course, he did not do it, yet he pocketed the money. He also got $8 billion NEPA contract to build the Yola Bauchi transmission line. $8 billion, I'm not saying million dollars, billion dollars. That was part of the $16 billion that Obasanjo's government wasted on power. Remember, there was a time he donated $1 million to the Rotary Foundation for Polio Eradication. He can afford it, that's how rich he is. There was one time that he illegally took £700,000 to UK, and of course UK deported him. In fact, he sued UK for deporting him. You guys remember that story? Anyway, that was the man that showed up in court when they started fighting over this house. Apparently, Emeka Ofor wanted the house. You know, there are two wings. Malami wanted one, Emeka Ofor wanted the other. Emeka allegedly partnered with Malami to get this man kicked out of his house. So Justice Umar at that time gave a verdict that this man should be kicked out of his house, and there are reports that Justice Umar was bribed. But within a week, they brought policemen to evict this man out of his house. I talked about this in 2013. Well, he appealed the case. In fact, popular human rights lawyer Femi Falana even set up a petition at that time that this powerful man must not get away with harassing this man and taking his property by force. Fortunately for this man, the appeal court said that he's the rightful owner of his house, that he did everything he was supposed to do, that they should give him back his house. And you know, we were all celebrating that finally justice has prevailed. Now lie, would you believe that despite that, Emeka Ofor and Malami decided to take the matter to the Supreme Court? This whole thing, they've been on this thing for about 4 years now, and they've been at the Supreme Court for the last 2 years. This man will travel to Nigeria for the court hearing, and then they will say it's been adjourned for another 6 months. The case has now been adjourned 4 different times in the last 2 years, and we still don't know what will happen. In the meantime, Emeka Ofor is occupying one of the houses. I mean, the judiciary in Nigeria is heartbreaking. Some people may say, why are you talking about this? It doesn't concern me. I'm telling you, it could happen to anybody. And if such has happened to you, please share your story in the comments below. Maybe you tried to take a matter to court and justice did not prevail, because it's very, very common. It's very rampant in Nigeria. And you know, if you are living abroad and you are hoping to go to Nigeria to go and build your own house and live there, you know, Koyodo has been saving. He said he wants to build a duplex. I've been telling him, don't tell anybody when you move to Nigeria. Don't put pictures of it on Facebook. I'm not saying that this man did that. I'm just saying some people, they cannot keep quiet. So I've been telling him not to broadcast cash to everybody. Although I don't know how he will afford a duplex when me, his boss, cannot afford a duplex myself. Anyway, but you know, it bothers me because this man, Alhaji Malami, is a Sokoto prince. He's very rich. He's an elder statesman. He's the former ambassador to South Africa. And he's also the chairman of Abuja Electricity Distribution Company. He has money. Emeka Ofor is the chairman of Chrome Group and Enugu Electricity Distribution Company. You think that they cannot afford their own houses? Of course they can afford their own houses, but they just have to have this man's house. Maybe they just want that location by fire, by force. I don't know. Emeka had his own bank, you know, African Express Bank. Remember, it was later liquidated. Apparently, the man was just taking money out of the bank, you know. He thought if you own a bank, it means you own all the money inside the bank. Anyway, finally, the bank was liquidated. I'm saying that this man could afford to build his own house, or if he wanted to buy it from this man, they could just approach him. And if the man wanted to sell, he would sell. And if he didn't want to sell, it is not by fire, by force. But they just decided that they can get this man's properties and they can get away with it, and that's what they've been doing. Please get the new Chief Justice. So Mr. Chief Justice, you not do well. We were all rooting for you on this show, you know, me and Kolo. We were saying that they must make you the Chief Justice by fire, by force, you know, because we are hoping that in your time true justice would prevail in Nigeria. Maybe you can start by ensuring justice on this case. I heard that the Supreme Court will give a judgment soon, maybe at the end of this month, I don't know. Hopefully they will not adjourn it again like they've been doing for so long. And by ensuring justice, I'm not just talking about making sure that people's houses are not forcefully taken away from them. No, it's not just about houses. Many people will ship things to Nigeria and custom officers will seize it from them and use it to extract money from them. Sometimes they will tell them to pay ridiculous amounts before they can be cleared. At the end of it, some people will just abandon their stuff. A few weeks ago, I talked about how they found 17 exotic vehicles at the home of the former customs boss. I mean, 17 vehicles. Those were vehicles of people that these officials liked. They really liked those vehicles, and they decided to seize them in order to use it to extract money from the owners by telling them to pay ridiculous amount as a custom fee. Sometimes some of these fees have no receipt, and you know, if you cannot pay the money, they would then tell you that they will auction the vehicle, and that is how they will give it to their friends. By the way, it's not just politicians that are taking advantage of the common people. I've been saying this for a long time. Nigerian soldiers must be checked, please. Is anybody watching me in the Nigerian government? You must check our soldiers. They are doing whatever they want to, eh? They think they can just do anything and get away with it. I'm sure you guys have seen pictures of the woman in Lagos. This woman that was brutalized by six uniformed soldiers, six men on one woman. Ah, father. No. That is not correct. Six men beating up one woman in broad daylight. Nigerian soldiers need to be completely reoriented. Why would you beat a civilian? Not to talk about beating a woman, and you call yourself a man. You have no shame. Hey, Lojuti, any man that beats a woman is a coward. Benny, apparently a soldier slapped her brother and she protested. That was how they bounced on her. I guess they wanted to kill her. So if a soldier is beating your brother or your sister, you are not supposed to see anything. You're just supposed to be watching. Eh? This mentality of the powerful doing anything to common people has got to stop in Nigeria. From seizing people's houses, seizing people's cars and stuff at custom, to beating people on the street. With some of the things that happen in Nigeria, sometimes you feel ashamed of being in Nigeria. No, seriously. Because the justice system is so very faulty. It's so ridiculous. And I hope that this woman gets justice. Although, knowing the Nigerian military, I doubt it. Because up till now, the military is covering up those soldiers that beat up this woman. They are not letting us see their faces. Apart from paying her huge ransom, and they should pay this woman millions of naira. I think those soldiers should be beaten the same way they beat this woman. I think their backs should also look like this. If the backs of those soldiers can look like this, I'm telling you, that would be the end of harassing civilians on the streets of Nigeria. Making me upset. You guys not doing anything. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. Moving on to Kenya. Can you guys believe that a governorship aspirant, this man wants to be a governor, eh? He decided to fly a helicopter in order to go and commission a wooden bridge. Oh my god, I'm so sorry. Oh, as if, heck no! And this man that we're talking about is an engineer. I'm talking about engineer Ephraim Maina. And I'm like, he wants to be a governor. He wants to be the governor of the Unyeri County, that is in the central province. So they asked him to come and commission a wooden bridge in Kabaru Ward. And he flew there in a helicopter. You're not even a governor yet. You're already chartering helicopters, you know, to go and commission a wooden bridge. I was like, African officials. And this is not peculiar to Kenya at all. This happens in different African countries. By the way, I heard about a borehole that they recently commissioned in Nigeria, and the borehole did not work. Oh my God, it was very embarrassing. And you know, it's a Nigerian organization in the US that donated money for the borehole, but for some reason, when they got there, the commissioner popped the thing, it did not work. And then the guy in charge of it was like, ah, the thing is working. You know, I took a shower this morning. I got water from the borehole, but the borehole did not work anymore. But going back to the man in Kenya, guess what? People will still vote for him. Despite the fact that he's already doing this when he's not governor, I won't be surprised if he wins, is what I'm saying. And while we're talking about Kenya, I want you guys to know that doctors and teachers have reached a deal with the government after 100 days of strike. Remember that we talked about the strike and the protest, and now they're back at work, and that's awesome. I just wanted to update you guys on that. You guys now don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. Moving on to Ethiopia, about 113 people lost their lives last week when a landslide happened at Koshe, that is Ethiopia's largest dump site. It's in the capital Addis Ababa. 113 people died. What I don't understand is that this dump site has been there for about 48 to 50 years. This thing has been there for decades, about 5 decades, and it's been piling up, and they could see that something like this is very dangerous. It is very hazardous. They knew that something like this could happen at any time. They knew it could happen. As a matter of fact, there's a committee that was set up 15 years ago to discuss how to prevent such an occurrence. In fact, I spoke with one of the committee members, that is Mr. Emias Lagasse, and he was on the committee 15 years ago, and he spoke with me at length. He was so upset with this whole thing. He said, Adeola, we've recommended for the government to relocate the people around that area since 15 years ago because the area is not healthy. It is hazardous to human health. He said it stinks so bad that even if you wind up your glass in the car, it still stinks. And then he said that they wanted the previous mayor, that is Ali Abdu, to buy medicines and antibiotics for the people that have been living there because everybody was getting sick. As a matter of fact, the school children at Koshe were getting sick almost every day. He said there was a time that students actually collapsed because they got sick. He also said they recommended that the government should turn the area to a biogas plant, that they should be using the dirt to produce electricity. And then the last thing he said they recommended was that they should invest in recycling instead of piling up trash. You know, they should have like recycling centers. Despite presenting their recommendations at every opportunity that they were given, at different meetings and conferences with the government, nothing was done. All their recommendations were pushed aside. In fact, the new mayor started building condominiums about 5 or 6 kilometers to the dump site, and they knew that this could happen. They knew that someday the trash are like mountains. They knew that a landslide could happen, and when it happened, guess what? It buried several houses. A lot of people were trapped beneath this trash. They started building a biogas plant without evacuating the people. And you know, this is not peculiar to Ethiopia. I mean, in Nigeria, a road is not bad until major accidents are happening and people are dying. That is when they will know, we need to repair this road. Not be so good to government buildings, dilapidated buildings. They would wait until the thing is almost crashing before they will know that they need to fix it. Hospitals, government hospitals, have you not been there? Sometimes you go to general hospital and you cannot breathe because it stinks at some of our general hospitals in Nigeria. Am I the only one? And they will just wait until everything is dilapidated before they know that they need to repair. So the government knew, at least the mayor of Koshe in Ethiopia knew, that this thing could come crashing down someday, and he didn't do anything. The government declared a 3-day mourning, and they also paid for funeral, but many people are saying it's too late. That will not bring back the dead. The damage is already done. A lot of people want the mayor to leave office, and they are saying that they shouldn't have waited till people died. Now, for those who lost their loved ones, I cannot imagine what you're going through. Please accept our condolences. May their souls rest in peace. You guys know I don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. So moving on to Rwanda, the wife of an opposition party leader has been held by police for 3 weeks now. 3 weeks. Without being allowed to communicate with others. I'm talking about Violet Uwamahoro. She's originally from Rwanda, but she's based in the UK. Her husband, that is Faustin Rukundo, is a member of the exiled opposition party, Rwanda National Congress. So this woman went to Rwanda to attend her father's funeral. And the last time anyone heard from her was when she first arrived in the capital, that is Kigali, on February the 14th. She made a phone call briefly when she arrived that she had landed, and her phone was shut off a few minutes after that. Initially, the government of Rwanda told the British Foreign Office that the police did not detain this woman. And then after some time, the police spokesman said that, this woman was apprehended based on a tip-off that they got, which claimed that this woman is involved in criminal dealings constituting serious crimes, including attempts to recruit people into a criminal network. they still did not tell us what the crime is. Let me say that again so that you understand how these people like to use grammar. How these people like to use grammar to justify injustice. And they said that this woman is involved in criminal dealings. We don't know what the criminal dealings are. They said that she's constituting serious crimes, including attempts to recruit people into a criminal network. We don't know the name of this criminal network. We don't know exactly what she did to recruit people. There is no evidence whatsoever. All I know is the Rwandan government has been detaining this woman for at least 3 weeks. And although the Rwandan law states that a person that is apprehended has the right to be informed of the charges against him or her, and they also said that they have the right to contact their family members and lawyers, guess what? According to Human Rights Watch, they did not allow this woman to exercise this right when they arrested her. It took weeks before they would allow the British Deputy High Commissioner to visit her in prison. Keep in mind that this woman is British. She's a British citizen. Now, arresting people and holding them incommunicado in detention has been going on for a long time in Rwanda. And the sad thing is, nobody can complain. There has been several incidents of people linked to opposition members disappearing, and the authority would never tell you whether they have them in custody or not. Why? It appears as if anybody in the opposition or anybody that does not like President Kagame must be arrested and called a terrorist. Why? Where is the democracy in Rwanda? You cannot publicly say anything bad about the president or be a member of the opposition in Rwanda. Bear in mind that Rwanda is an important ally of the UK and the United States, even till now. They are strong supporters of Rwanda in return for Rwanda to send their troops to conflict zones in Africa, you know, like Sudan, like South Sudan, and the Central African Republic. So the woman is still in custody, and it's just ridiculous because she went to bury her father, and all of a sudden we are hearing that she's involved in some criminal network, and we still don't know the name of the criminal network, and they are not releasing this woman. Meanwhile, there are so many people that believe that you are not supposed to say anything bad about the president of Rwanda because he's developing his country. I want to know what you guys think in the comments below. There's also the argument that he's allegedly taking resources from Congo to develop Rwanda. That is a topic for another day, but I want to know what you guys think. The man has been president for 17 years and he recently extended his right to rule till 2034. That means the people that were born the year he became president, they will grow up, go to university, they will get married and have their kids, and he will still be president. I'm just saying. So the fact that he's developing his country, does that mean they can just arrest people anyhow and detain people anyhow in Rwanda? Let me know what you guys think in the comments below. You guys don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. Moving on to Equatorial Guinea. Did you guys see that video where a woman was beaten up in a police station? That's enough. That is enough. Can you imagine? I mean, I don't even care whatever she did. This is now what happens. Like, a policeman can now beat you as the punishment for whatever the offense is. And did you notice that they kept beating her on her buttocks? I think this policeman just wanted to harass this woman sexually because he kept targeting her buttocks. Yes, this is wrong. What a shame that this is happening. It's making me upset. You guys not doing anything. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. So before I sign out, I can't believe I'm not able to raise $10,000 on this show. It's very sad. Very, very sad. I'm still trying to get food to the IDPs in Nigeria. Please, daddy and mommy. Anybody that is watching me that can donate for us to get food to the IDPs in Nigeria, please help us to make this a reality. We're still trying to raise $10,000 since January, eh? But having said that, I would like to thank everybody that has donated. I'm so grateful to every one of you. Thank you so much, everybody that has donated through GoFundMe as well as PayPal. I'm so grateful to every one of you, but we are yet to get to our goal. This is where we are right now. In case anybody out there would still be willing to donate for us, we have about 2 million internally displaced people in Nigeria, and we have enough food to feed more than 900,000 in a year. We're trying to get the food from Utah to Texas and then to Nigeria. So if you can donate to make this a reality, please, we'll be so grateful. All right, you guys not know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real.
Growing up in Kenya, my sister and I were very close. But like any sisters, we fought a lot. She always got new clothes and I always got hand-me-downs. Now she's putting her children through school in Kenya. We still fight sometimes, especially when I send money for the kids. I tell her, buy some clothes for the younger one, and we both laugh.
With nearly 500,000 locations, our app and online, this is moving money for better.
Alright y'all, it's been real and I'm keeping it real right up in here. Don't forget to follow me on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Until next week, I'm gonna see y'all later. Peace out!